Joining us now live in studio, presidential candidate Marianne Williamson. Marianne, welcome.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
No problem. All right, let's get started. So you're running for president. Yeah. You're the most progressive of the three candidates on the Democratic side, obviously Biden, RFK Jr., and yourself. I just checked, Real Clear Politics has your average at 6% and Kennedy at 13%. Mm. And so that's just the average, but it's not the latest poll. So given that you're the most progressive, Marianne, why do you think that more voters haven't come over to your side as they did for Bernie and some others in progress in the last two races?
Well, first of all, I want to point out that in the New York Times poll yesterday on the front page, yesterday, the day before, Bobby was at 13 and I was at 10. And that is definitely a gold standard poll. So that's good news. And I think particularly given how invisibilized I've been, how blackballed I've been from certain mainstream media, etc., holding on to that 10 is a big deal. Why more people on the left have not embraced my candidacy? I spent a lot of time trying to analyze that and think about that, and it does me no good at a certain point. I don't understand it, and it's difficult even to talk about, because how can you talk about it without sounding whiny?
Can I ask you something related to that? Because the current political landscape today, I think, is very different from what it was in 2016. I'm noticing a bit of a realignment when it comes to the electorate. I don't know if you can speak to that at all, where there seems to be a lot of disappointment with the Democratic Party. There has definitely been a fracturing of the left wing of the Democratic Party. The Justice Democrats, for instance, there's a big story out today about how they're really losing a lot of power and political capital. And so I'm wondering if there's just this level of disempowered left wing voters who are kind of trying to find a home somewhere. I'm just curious what you think about when you talk to people on the campaign trail. Like, what are you noticing in terms of the rhetoric you're hearing, the conversations you're having?
What I notice is that realignment. You know, you just said they lost power. No, they've abdicated power, and they continue to abdicate power. And they abdicate power every time they endorse Biden. So what are we, it's ridiculous, actually. The left needs some spine, in my opinion. So at this point, what I'm addressing is the realignment that's out there. Gen Z voters who don't really care about this conversation about 2016, they care about the fact they do not have health care. Mm-hmm. They care about the fact that they have college loans. They care about the fact that they cannot afford to pay for college. They care about the fact that they don't have paid family leave, that they don't have a guaranteed living wage. This is what I see on the street. People who are just, those conversations seem elite to them at this point. And that's what I'm speaking into. And I also feel another very significant realignment has to do with anti-corporatism itself. You know, if this was 10 years ago, I would feel like, don't you get it? Corporations are ruling the world, don't you get it? We don't have universal health care because of insurance companies. People are rationing their insulin because of pharmaceutical companies. And we don't have green energy because of big oil. We have toxins in our food and water because of big chem, big agriculture, big food companies. We have, our foreign policy is dominated by defense contractors. And 10 years ago, I might see some blank stares. Today, No. We have enough people in this country on both left and right. Remember, among Republicans as well as Democrats, the majority want universal health care. Mm-hmm. Among the Republicans as well as Democrats, the majority want tuition-free college and tech school. Among Republicans and Democrats, even among gun owners, they want common sense gun safety laws. So I'm just moving forward talking to people. And the people I talk to, whether it's Gen Z, just the people out there, New Hampshire, South Carolina, Michigan, Nevada, they're not thinking, well, what is the left gonna do? That's just not where they live.
But it's interesting because the power players in the media, the power players in Washington, seem to want to really focus on what divides Americans. And I think that is a nonpartisan effort. The unwillingness to really talk about what American voters overwhelmingly agree on as opposed to what they disagree on.
Because they're creating a false dichotomy. They create, look over here, because they don't want you to look up there. It's a don't look up thing. The real axis is between the powerful and the powerless. The real axis is between those who have capital and easy access to capital versus those who are just struggling to get by. And I think enough people, at least in my experience, are open to hearing that. And of course, they don't want to look at what's real because they do more. This is legalized bribery we've got here. They do more to serve the short-term profit maximization of their donors than to serve the expressed will of their constituents. Not just the safety, health, and well-being of their constituents, but even the expressed will of their constituents. That's how deep the corruption is. And my sense out in America is people are so ready to go past whether or not they see this. The real question is, okay, what are we going to do about it? And continuing to endorse Biden is not pushing Biden left.
Definitely
so,
not.
Marianne, you have a populist message that we just heard, which resonates in all quarters of politics. We've seen it now in 100 different cases. And one of the reasons, honestly, that Trump rose up on the right. You know,
yeah,
people always say racism, sexism, bigotry, and there's a lot of truth to that. But there's a huge amount of the electorate that didn't back Trump because of that. They backed him because of the powerful versus the powerless, as you just discussed here. And certainly progressives feel that way.
Mm-hmm.
You just outlined a whole bunch of policies, paid family leave and the others that you just listed, that are very progressive, that we know for a fact, not just progressives, but Democratic voters overall.
And Republicans.
And by the way, Republicans, but like about 90, for example, again, take paid family leave. 94%, I believe, of Democrats are in favor of it, and 84% of the whole country, 74% of Republicans, et cetera.
I mean, I think our elected lawmakers should wait for those poll numbers to go up a little bit more before they
just in case.
Right, and that joke goes to the point I'm going to make. So your positions, and I think this is just a simple matter of fact. You could say, hey, I still don't agree with her positions, or I'm still not going to vote for her, but your positions are, looking at the polling numbers, the most popular, and certainly on the Democratic side, and you have your finger on the pulse on populism, etc. But yet, the numbers are not going up. Now, I have a theory about that. It's one I shared with you before you even started your campaign, which is your number one opponent is going to be media, because they're going to do two things. One is shut you out, and the other is say that you can't win. So that's how they attack all progressives, and then they go, "Oh, I didn't attack. I'm just saying something that, you know, that we all believe." Who's we? Who's all? Like, because if you, like, I can make a case that Joe Biden can't win. An incumbent that is under 50% almost never wins. He's often under 40%. So he could, you could argue that he's the least electable, but no one in media other than me has ever made that argument.
I mean, well, the New York Times latest poll shows that he's in a dead heat with Donald Trump, who was just arraigned for his third indictment.
100%, but let me get to the question.
Yeah.
So given all of that, but what I'm interested in is, as you're living this now for the second time, what is it that you think actually causes that mechanism? Like what, like how does it get put into play? Because I don't think it's a memo. I don't think it's a conspiracy. I don't think the New York Times and the Washington Post talk and say, hey, let's make sure we keep out Marianne.
Oh, I think they do.
Okay, interesting. Go ahead.
I absolutely think they do. I can't tell you how many times we've been booked and then it's canceled.
Oh.
Yeah, absolutely. Of course they do. She's not, don't have her on. Absolutely. You better believe it. Don't have her on. Yeah, no, that's exactly how it works. And the hit pieces and the smears and the president's press secretary coming onto the podium at the White House to mock me. Absolutely, it's intentional. And it's intentional because they know that I'm saying the things. It's not like they don't know that these are the popular positions. They do know that these are the popular positions. So they say, don't let her on to say it because she could start a wildfire. And that's why I feel that the 10% I have, given the blackballing, given the hits, I'm thinking we're doing pretty well.
Well, you know, I remember in 2016, Senator Sanders wasn't even really on my radar. Like he had already entered the race, but I didn't really take his candidacy seriously until the first Democratic primary debate. And given what your numbers are, given what RFK Jr.'s numbers are, it is fascinating that those percentages have not translated to a commitment by the DNC to have a debate. And I think, regardless of what you think about the candidates, you know, primarying Biden, you should be in favor of allowing that debate to happen. The American electorate deserves to hear the ideas espoused by all these different candidates, and the inability to even have that debate, I think, is anti-democratic, which is ironic given what the Democratic Party has really hung its hat on over the last election, which is we got to save our democracy.
Yeah.
Well, what good is a democracy when you're intentionally trying to drown out candidates that want to challenge the incumbent?
And they have been saying that, and it's very undemocratic. And the American people, particularly at this time, should be listening to all of the options. They should be hearing what President Biden has planned for 4 years. What do I have planned for the next 4 years? And what does Bobby Kennedy have planned for the next 4 years? Because those are very different agendas. And it should be the American people who make the decision. It should not be like a bunch of men 100 years ago smoking cigars deciding who the candidate will be. And the role of the traditional role of the Democratic Party is to stand to the back until the electorate has decided. But hey, it's a major multi-billion dollar corporation. That's really what we're talking about here. And there is institutional resistance to anyone but Biden because they've decided it for now. And the larger institutional resistance is the system itself. Mm-hmm. And the entire matrix of corporate tyrants, whether it's insurance, pharmaceutical, big ag, big chemical, big food, gun manufacturers and chemical companies and big oil and defense contractors. And all that the political parties are doing is chopping wood and carrying water for them because those are their donors. And that's what I think Americans are understanding. It's a bigger picture. And it really is, we need a new progressive era to push back against the second golden age, just like what happened before.
So I want to dive into that institutional resistance that you mentioned there, because that's the one thing I'm most interested in. Because now, okay, latest poll is at 10%.
Yeah.
10% is an undeniable number.
Yes.
So Andrew Yang, and I like Andrew, but he didn't get near 10% in the last time around. Of course, different factors, there's a lot more people running, etc. But you're running against an incumbent president, you're sitting at 10%, yet no one's talked about a town hall for you.
I know, it's unbelievable. And I had a town hall on CNN last time. Yes, and they gave, Fox gave Bobby a town hall, News Nation, well, they gave him a thing with Sean Hannity. I know, it's kind of like, hello, the invisibilization, the erasure is unbelievable. And that's why I need the support at Marianne2024.com. For me to be able to build my own media structure out enough to be able to override that.
So Marianne, what do you think happens though? I mean, I generally tend to think that it's groupthink, but maybe it's more than groupthink. Have you noticed a sense, anything that leads you to believe the institutional power of the Biden administration affecting decisions, whether it's the DNC or affecting the media itself?
All I know is we'll make a deal with a vendor and then get a call from the vendor. Oh, I'm really sorry, we really like you, but we can't do this.
Oh, wow.
Oh, over and over and over again. And there's one state, I don't wanna say what it is. I can't, we try to hire someone and they're really excited. And then 2 days later, I'm really sorry, I'm not gonna be able to do this. Clearly, whether it's as simple as if you help her, you will not work in this town again. You will not work for the DNC. Oh, it's smutty out there.
Oh, I believe it.
It's like, wow.
Yeah, same thing happened on a very tiny scale to me when I ran for Congress. We'd go have a debate scheduled, the main Democratic opponent doesn't want the debate, and she has connections to that place. She's the state assembly person. Next thing you know, oh, last second we canceled the debate.
Exactly.
No explanation.
Exactly.
And that happens over and over again. And people don't see it. Part of the reason they don't see it is because the media refuses to cover it.
Absolutely. But you know what? This is how I look at this next election. And by the way, you were talking about Bernie before. Polls showed over and over again that he would have beaten Trump.
Right.
My concern about 2024, first of all, the American people are not in the mood for another Trump-Biden contest. There's no appetite for it. A president who has given more oil drilling permits than even Trump did, a president who approved the Willow Project, calls himself the climate president. This is so absurd. The admittedly healthy investments in green energy that are in the Inflation Reduction Act are completely nullified by all of his gifts, subsidies and allowances to big oil. My concern is not the people who will vote for Trump. My concern is how many people will stay home in 2024. I've met so many young people, they are not showing up to vote for a president who approved the Willow Project and approved so many oil drilling.
It's interesting that you bring that up, because just yesterday I covered a story about a group of Democratic strategists. They're referring to themselves as the White Stripe Project. And they are trying to bring in white voters without a college degree who apparently sit it out. They don't go to the polls, they don't vote. And so their whole strategy is to use data in order to lean into race politics, to encourage them to come to the polls. Like, it makes no sense to me whatsoever. And it makes me think, well, there's a real good possibility that Trump could get elected.
There is absolutely a good possibility.
And if that's the kind of strategy they have in mind, I mean, let's address anything other than what is popular with the electorate, which is, you know, policy, universal policy that materially improves people's lives.
Exactly. And Franklin Roosevelt said we wouldn't have to worry about a fascist takeover as long as democracy delivered on its promises. The problem is that democracy is not delivering on its promises. Every other advanced democracy has universal health care. 1 in 4 Americans live with a medical debt. We have people rationing our insulin in this country. 68,000 people die every year from lack of health care. 85 million uninsured or underinsured. 18 million who cannot afford to pay for the prescriptions their doctors give them. Offer people a life in which democracy is delivering on its promises. Once again, every other advanced democracy has tuition-free college and tech school. That's how we're going to win in 2024. And that's why I'm going to stay in here. And that's why I'm inching forward. And that's why I believe, because I heard you say it, and I have quoted it so many times. I heard you say, I was just watching you one day, and you said, somebody is going to break through. And I believe that with all my heart. And on a certain level, it doesn't even matter who it is. We all have to just keep leaning on that wall, leaning on it, whether it's a podcast, whether it's a TV network, whether it's a candidacy. It's not as important as that we just keep leaning on the wall. And I agree with you, somebody is going to break through.
So I apologize for the way I phrase this, and I hope you don't take offense to it, but I want to know, what do you think makes you special? Because we have several Justice Democrats elected into Congress. They're not corrupt. They didn't take corporate money. They didn't take corporate PAC money. They don't have big donors. They certainly took small dollar donors, and they said everything that you're telling us right now. But what is your theory of change? How are we to believe, let's say, in a world where we have genuinely free and fair elections and the press doesn't try to suppress you, and you win? What would you do differently?
I wouldn't care about getting reelected. Mm-hmm. To do what I want to do, first of all, nothing makes me special, but I'm here. That's the only thing, is that I'm here. Yeah. I'm not thinking about, ooh, they'll get mad at me and they'll take my committee assignment away, and I won't get Nancy's or whomever's or Hakeem's cell phone number anymore, and they won't primary me if I'm a good girl and I'll play along or a good boy. That's the only thing. It's not special. It's just I'm not one of them. Mm-hmm. They can't do anything for me. That's why I think it has to be somebody from the outside at this point. Because they, and I think I heard you say that also, what that system says is that you're only qualified to do this if you are qualified to maintain and perpetuate the system as it is. My qualification is that I know how to disrupt it. How do I know? I'm doing it. I'm right here, right now. Somebody has to just say the quiet part out loud. So everything that you said, yeah, they're willing to say it within the context of permission granted by the system. Mm-hmm. I would be more like Roosevelt. I welcome their hatred. And I would govern in a way that nobody could possibly do if they were thinking about even trying to be reelected. I think of myself as, I want to give this country a chiropractic adjustment. The people need our, you know, the government needs its heart, and the people need our spine, for God's sake. And then do it for 4 years, get in there, and then hand it over to a younger generation that deserves it at this point.
Last question for me, Marianne. So you make a compelling case here, and when I see you in person and we talk in person and on air, you sound completely different than how the media portrays you, right? So like the media has you as unelectable and crystals and rocks and just and internal turmoil. Everything is negative.
You're very mean to your staff.
I throw phones and I.
Yeah, whereas Biden, by the way, curses all the time. And the first time they ever wrote a story about it was a couple of weeks ago. Mm-hmm. Is like, oh, lovable grandpa from Scranton apparently tearing people's heads off internally, but nobody ever reports it. But anyway, but my point here, Marianne, is, or my question is, so you got this compelling case, but the media says only Biden can beat Trump. And so that is the number, and by the way, that is exactly how the media defeated Bernie Sanders. It wasn't Biden who defeated Bernie Sanders.
Absolutely, poll after poll after poll said he was the one who would have beaten him.
Yeah, and same thing with Hillary Clinton. So, but my question is, Marianne, what is your case for why you could do better than Biden against Trump or any Republican?
First of all, for everything that we've been talking about here, my agenda is the agenda that aligns with the will of the American people. That's why, that's number one. Offer people an agenda that will materially unshackle them from the economic conditions that are holding them down. When you have one third of America's workforce living on less than $13 an hour, half of them unable to find a job, half of America's seniors living on less than $25,000 a year, I'm offering an agenda not only of the universal healthcare, the tuition-free college, the paid family leave, the childcare, the guaranteed sick pay and guaranteed livable wage, my economic bill of rights, housing. Also, it's time to declare a climate emergency. It's time to declare a climate emergency. Mass mobilization, let's transition justly from a dirty economy to a clean economy. And let's have a Department of Peace and transition from a war economy to a peace economy. The reason I'm the one who can beat Trump is because I have something to offer. And I agree with you, if we're gonna talk about somebody who is a weak candidate, the president is a weak candidate. This is not the same race as 2020, and I don't think he's the one to beat Trump. Let me end there.
All right, look, we'll have the link to your website, as we do with all the candidates we interview, in the description box. But what's the website again?
Marianne2024.
And I will say this, look, no matter what you think of the policies, her questions here, her answers here, etc. The one thing she said that I have to agree with is she showed up, right? And that takes courage and that takes spine. And a ton of people did not show up, but here's Marianne representing the actual progressive position in this race. So Marianne, for that alone, we thank you and we appreciate you coming
here to make your case. Thank you very much, wonderful to be with you.
Thanks for watching The Young Turks, really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.